Thank you, created awesome. We welcome you again to World Press. If you're here for the first time, we hope you find this to be a place that's loving and safe. Our goal is to be the most loving place in town and a safe place to connect with God, wherever we're coming from. And we want to say a special hello to our friends in Tampa Bay. We pray that the Holy Spirit is with you, even as we sense the Spirit of the Lord here in Burlingame, California. And it's Father's Day, which we know is a good day for many of us. It's a sad day for others of us. It's also when we think about our fathers who may not be with us anymore, it's a loaded day. But we want you to know that, again, we lifted up the idea that we could be a father to people in this church. So maybe there's somebody that you can think of today that you can kind of be a mentor to going forward. But we have thought about this. We thought about, like, what gifts could we give out today, and we really prayed, like, could all the dads get, like, a free tie was one idea, and, you know, who needs another tie? No one wears ties in Burlingame anyway. We thought about we could give everyone, like, a free piece of beef jerky, like a Slim Jim, you know, or something like that, but it's not gluten-free, so we couldn't do that. So this is what we really contemplated. There is an actual thing. It's a new thing for dads. It's called a daddle. This is a real thing. It's a saddle for dads. The advertisement on this said, "Ride off into the sunset on your dad." Not sure how I feel about that, really. Gives new meaning to the idea of having a pain in the back as your kid. But seriously, what we wanted to do was offer everyone here today, and dads, a little wisdom about the nexus moments of our lives, the nexus moments. And a nexus is the coming together of two things. A nexus is also an ability to look backwards and to look forwards. A nexus is a mountaintop that we have clarity about our lives about. And God gives us these nexuses, these nexes, if you will, now and then. And we want to lift up the nexuses of our lives. And perhaps you're not at a nexus right now, but I can guarantee you someday you will be. And perhaps you have already been through a nexus and you're trying to figure out what to do with that moment of clarity that God gave you. So let's pray and then let's talk about these nexes of our lives. Father, thank you that you are the God of all things. You are a good God, as we just heard, a good, good Father. And we live in a world that is not always so good. I pray, Lord, that over the next few moments, you would use these words of mine, that this just wouldn't be another Sunday sermon, but you would take these nexus points of our lives and that you would do something rich and deep and full and true with those spaces. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, in 1862, a man named Victor Hugo wrote a novel, what is considered to be the greatest novel of the 19th century. The novel is, of course, Les Miserables. And Les Mis is, of course, not just the greatest novel of the 19th century, but was made into one of the most famous shows ever on Broadway, Les Mis. You may remember that story. It was about a true rebellion that happened in 1815 in Paris in the streets in June, the June Rebellion. But the movie and the show and the book were really about a character named Jean Valjean who has a series of redemption moments. He's an ex-con. He flees a prison, and all of the book and all of the movie and all of the show are about how Jean Valjean is being pursued by this character named Javert. But there's a nexus moment that happens about three-quarters of the way through the book and also the show and the movie, where Jean Valjean realizes that his own life will not carry on forever. In fact, he is sick, and he knows that his life will be coming to an end. And at that same moment, he knows that he has such love for this young man who isn't even his son. It's his son-in-law named Marius. And Marius is in trouble. He is in prison. And so at this nexus moment, Jean Valjean finds himself looking back on all that his life has been, looking forward on all that his life will not continue to be. Let's pick up on Jean Valjean and Les Mis later in the worship service. But I want you to think about the nexus moments of your lives, and it doesn't even have to be a moment towards the end of your life, or it doesn't have to be this heavy, heavy moment. It could just be a moment of clarity. One of my best friends is a guy named Dan Meyer, who you know and love and was your pastor for so many years. And he spoke at my installation, and he was here also for the Palm Sunday worship service. But what you may not know about Dan is he had a Nexus moment right before he came out to speak on Palm Sunday. He has a wonderful family. He has three wonderful sons, and he and Amy have spent their whole lives raising these incredible young men. And the thing is, each of them have left the home. And right before he came out to speak here, his youngest son, Reed, went to college, went to the University of Missouri, went to Mizzou, and he dropped his son off, and he said goodbye, and he helped him to pack up his room, and then he had this kind of Nexus moment when he realized that his life wouldn't kind of be the same anymore without his kids in the house. And then he got a call from home. His wife, Amy, told him that his best friend, his dog named Christmas, had just passed away. And Dan talks about how he pulled the car over to the side of the road and he just started to weep. And there God met him at that Nexus moment. Again, it doesn't have to be like even kids leaving the house. It can just be a thing that happens in a career or a life trajectory. Our incredible worship leader, Alex, who leads us so remarkably. We have such a talented guy in Alex. Should we just give him a quick yes, thank you? He makes it look so easy. What you may not know about Alex is he actually was going to be a professional athlete at a point in his life. He was a very, very, very good baseball player. He played baseball, third baseman in high school. He played it in college, and he had every possibility of being in the majors. That had been his whole goal in life, and he could have done it, except that he had this back injury. And it was such a serious back injury that he went to the doctor, and the doctor said, you know, son, you're going to be okay. Your back's going to recover, but you will never play baseball again. And for Alex, that was a Nexus moment because he'd spent his whole life trying to build up to this thing. And Alex so poetically and powerfully talks about how that was actually the moment that his faith really took root. His faith journey began right at that Nexus moment. And then he went into music. And we are so grateful that he did. And he's been playing and singing to the Lord ever since at that Nexus spot. Now, I have done men's retreats, maybe 15 of them. I have counseled hundreds of men of all ages. People who are in their later years, younger years, have come into my office through the years. And as a pastor of about 20 years, I have noticed that men get into trouble when they either at those Nexus moments don't look back in gratitude for what God has done. And gratitude is such an important part of life. I'm reminded of the young man who did not take care of his life. He was not grateful. He was not really happy or thankful for anything. He had a major heart attack. He goes in to the doctor, and the doctor says, I can fix your heart. And so a 4 or 5 hour surgery occurs, and after that, the young man says, ungratefully to the doctor who saved his life, he says, so is my heart going to pump as much blood as it used to? And the doctor said, yep, it's going to pump as much blood as you need. And then the young man ungratefully, unthankfully said, well, you know, but doctor, what's going to be my quality of life? And the doctor said, well, son, I have fixed your heart, but the quality of your life is up to you. And that boils for men and for all people down to a sense of gratitude. As we look over our lives and we see all that God has done, is it a moment of gratitude or is it a moment of anger or bitterness or something else? The second way that I have seen men get into trouble, and it happens to all people, but men get into trouble when they don't live into the realities of their lives. And those realities don't even have to be heavy, dark ones. It can be just beautiful realities that people don't want to live into. And this happened this last week. Maybe you follow the news. A guy named Mark Sanford, who was running for Congress in South Carolina, and he lost in the primary, and I have to say I was kind of sad that he lost in the primary. But it was actually a Nexus moment that happened many years before. It was a Father's Day weekend. when he said he was going on a hiking trip on the Appalachian Trail. And instead of living into the beautiful reality of his wonderful family and his wonderful life, he was governor of South Carolina. He could have been president of the United States. He gets on a plane and has an affair with a woman that he doesn't even know. And Mark was later asked, why? Why? You had everything. Your family is so beautiful. And he reflected on it a moment, and he said, you know, I just couldn't live into that reality. And so men get into trouble when they don't want to live into the beautiful and sometimes the challenging realities of their lives. So let's change gears a little bit. Let's look at another man who lives in the year 1500 BC. His name is Moses, and he is 120 years old. And he has had a tough career. God told him, back when he was in his early 80s, that he was going to lead 1 million Israelites out of Egypt into the promised land. Now, Moses did not want to do this. This was not what he'd signed up for in his life. But on top of that mountain Horeb, where the burning bush spoke to him, he accepted this call, and he did lead the Israelites out of their meat pots, out of Egypt, into the wilderness. And he did everything God asked him to do, everything. And then he gets to 120 years old, and he faces a nexus. Let's look at this nexus that I'm calling his Nebo nexus. Let's listen for God's word. It's interesting, we often think about Moses as a shepherd, but actually he was really a mountain climber. He climbed that first mountain, Mount Horeb. That's where he got the burning bush, Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments. And now he sees before him a mountain named Nebo. And let's listen for our text. Then Moses climbed Mount Nebo. This is a 2,231-foot mountain, and he climbs it when he's 120. Not bad. From the plains of Moab, you can almost feel the heat coming off of the desert as it hovers just above the sand and the million Israelites who are down there, to the tip of Pisgah across from Jericho. So he's there on top, and this is the view from the top of Nebo, and this is where he has this nexus. Now, the text doesn't tell us this, but I just have this feeling that at that nexus moment, Moses looks back onto the wilderness, this place that he had been for 40 years, and he thinks about all that God had brought him through. You know, the Egyptians attacking, the Red Sea, the lack of food and water, these griping, grumbling Israelites he hung out with for 40 years, their naughty behavior, I mean, the whole thing. But I just imagine that he looked back on the wilderness. And I also believe that he had thanks. He had gratitude. The text doesn't tell us this, but later in the text it says that Moses looked at God and saw him face to face. And that's another way of saying that. You can't actually look at God face to face unless you have a sense of gratitude. So I just believe that Moses is up there and he's just looking at it all and thinking about it all at this nexus moment and just says, Yahweh, thank you. And then he turns the other direction. He turns towards the promised land, and the text tells us there the Lord showed him the whole land from Gilead to Dan, all of Naphtali, the territory of Ephraim and Manasseh. This is the view from the top in the previous picture. All the land of Judah, the Mediterranean, the Negev, the whole region of the Valley of Jericho, the city of palms, Azora. He saw the promised land. He saw all that he had been going for. And then the Lord said to him, this is the land I promised you. And Moses must, from the top, have said to himself, I know, I remember, 40 years ago, it's about to happen, I can't wait. 40 years, it's been a hard one, but yes, I promised you. And God says, I promised Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And Moses must have thought about all the promises that were made to Abraham and the stars in the sky and Jacob and Isaac. And now it was about to happen. And God says to Moses, I will give it to your descendants. Whoa, wait. Descendants? No. You could just hear the anger in his heart maybe beginning to develop. He says, God says, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it. I like the King James much better. You will not go thither. No one uses the word thither anymore. Now, I'm just guessing at this Nebo Nexus, Moses must have had a whole series of feelings, but anger must have been way up there. Really? 40 years? I've done everything you've asked me to do, everything. I listened to them, I got the water out of the rock, I got the spit from the pigeons that you called manna. I mean, I've done everything. Really? I mean, if I was Moses, I'd have been like, really? Two can play at this game. Israelites were heading back to Egypt. But he doesn't. At that Nebo Nexus, God meets him there. And we don't exactly know what happens with Moses. But later texts, the Talmudic texts, would tell us that angels picked up Moses and took him to heaven. Our scriptures tell us that at that moment, Moses, the servant of the Lord, died right at that Nebo Nexus. And it goes on to say that there in Moab, the Lord said he would bury him in Moab, the valley opposite of Beth Peor. But to this day, no one knows where the grave is. Moses is 120 years old when he died, and yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength was gone. Now, that would seem like the end of the story, except that God lifts up another young man to lead this group. And what's interesting is this young man is not even Moses' son. His name would be Joshua. He was just an assistant, an intern. The Hebrew is na'ar, which just means literally an aide. He was the water boy. This guy that Moses had laid his hand upon. And on this Father's Day, I just want to say to all of you dads especially that there is somebody in your life, I know there is, that you could be the Moses to and lay your hand upon. It's maybe not your son or your daughter, but you could just lay your hands upon them and pray over them and just pour your life into them. Because those are the people who are going to go to the promised land. And that's in fact what happens, and that's what the next book is all about. But I just love the way this text ends. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all the signs and wonders the Lord had sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh, to all the officials. For no one has ever shown in the mighty power or been performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. Why was he the greatest? Because he got all of his goals planned, his success, his promised land? No, he didn't. But he was faithful, he was grateful, and he lived into the reality with God at his side. And it's one of my favorite texts in the Bible. It never gets preached. 3,507 years after Moses went to the top of Mount Nebo, another man would walk to the top, would not walk, but would go to the top of Nebo, and his name would be Graham Baird. So in about 2007, my wife Star and I had this incredible chance to go to Egypt and in Jordan. And one of the things at the end of that trip was to be able to go and visit Nebo, Mount Nebo. And I do have to say, I did not walk to the top of the mountain. It was over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and even in a tour bus when we went to the top of it, I was tired when I got out of that bus. But as I looked from the top of that mountain, and I was in my mid-30s, I had a Nebo Nexus. I looked back on the wilderness that Moses had looked at 3,507 years before. And I thought about how much God had done to bring me through my wilderness times. How much God had done to bring me through my college years, my early adulthood years. How many of those wilderness moments God had brought me through. And, you know, I didn't speak Hebrew or anything, but I did have this sense of gratitude for God, for what he had done through this wilderness that I'd experienced in a lot of my youth. And then I remember turning towards the promised land where Moses had looked 3,507 years before. And I wondered about some of the realities that I had been facing. So I was a pastor of this really great church, incredible church. It was just wonderful, this new church development. I mean, it was going gangbusters. I was just so over the moon. It's just that it wasn't exactly everything I was maybe thinking it might be. And I sort of had some of those realities. And at that point, Star and I had been married about 7 years, and you know, we hadn't had kids, and I think Star and I were kind of at this moment where we're like, well, I guess maybe we're not going to have kids, and that's okay. But it would be like the next year that we would go to the promised land, and we would find out about God bringing an incredible young girl into our lives, who was born into our lives, Haley. And then 4 years later, we would have an incredible, wonderful creation named Sheena brought into our lives. And then 4 years after that, we'd have this incredible, wonderful person named Ewan brought into our lives. And, you know, honestly, at that moment, I was like, Lord, just kind of stop blessing me right now, please. It's enough blessing for me. But I can tell you at that Nebo Nexus, God was there. And God is at your nexus too. So just three things. One, at your nexus, be grateful. Be grateful for what God has done. I was at the gym last week with my two-year-old. It's summer, and so we're hanging out together. And I was at the gym, and my son was opening and closing all of the lockers, everyone in the entire gym. And then he was taking the towels out and putting them in and taking the towels out and putting them in and taking them out. Then he was working on the shaving cream and then working on... And I was a little frustrated, and this older guy said to me, be grateful. You're going to miss this moment someday. And I've been thinking about that. And so, you know, if you're a dad, whatever age your kids are, be grateful. And the second thing to remember is just to live into the realities, and that doesn't have to mean a hard, heavy thing, but it can just mean live into your reality in a beautiful way. That's the place that God puts you. Or as the rock band REM would say, you just need to stand in the place where you live. And I love what Winston Churchill once said, who faced a lot of realities. He said, you know, the great thing is to get the true picture, whatever it is. And that is where God's beauty will find himself in your life. There's a church in Southern California called Reality. I don't know if it's made it up here yet, but it's a good church. But my favorite thing about Reality is the name. The whole premise behind the church is that God is in the real, not the imagined or the imaginary. He's in the real. And when we live into the real, there we live into God. And of course, the last thing is that the nexus is the cross. And that we can bring our nexuses and our nexies to God's nexus. All of our hopes and our dreams and our visions, all of our disappointments, everything can be brought to the cross. So I began the message with Jean Valjean at that nexus moment. I want to just offer a prayer that he gave in the middle of that great show. And as I offer this prayer, I want you to think about your nexus moment. And I want you to ask where God is in that space. Let's pray. My knees.
like the sun I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summer's died one by one. Soon they fly on, and I am old, and will be gone. Bring him peace, bring him joy. He is young, he is only a boy. You can tell.